Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And let me at the outset advise colleagues I will not be deploying my ever-popular Reverend I Am Jolly imitation this afternoon. Others do it so much better than I do. Let me just start by referring to the Minister's opening remarks where he said he was not speaking in a vacuum. And of course, a vacuum is an entirely theoretical thing, rather like infinity, because it is impossible when you consider the Heisenberg uncertainty principle and the reverse temporal connection that is associated with the Higgs boson for there to be any part of the universe which is wholly empty of matter. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle means that, of course, we don't know if there's anything in a particular space until we test it, and then, of course, having tested it and detected it, it is no longer there. Now, of course, this is the sort of language which, fascinating in a superficial way, is meaningless, in a minute, meaningless to a great many other people. So we have to speak in more simple ways. We have to use examples that are more simple. And I, before coming to a former mathematics teacher, want to just give a little story about my mathematics teacher, who is Doc Ingalls, who is a wonderfully bluff Lancastrian, who in the first year at school took us round the school searching for infinity. We took the blackboards down, we couldn't find it. We looked in the school dustbins, we couldn't find it. We went out into the playing fields, we couldn't find infinity. To this day, I remember that exercise, and infinity means something to me. I'm going to take Mr. Gray, if I may.
Ian Gray.
Well, the moment's kind of passed, but I just wanted to point out that, of course, you can't talk in a vacuum because sound doesn't travel in a vacuum, the advantage of which being that nobody would be able to hear us scream, Mr. Stevenson.
Stuart Stevenson.
The scream of Schrodinger's cat. That's a rather private reference. I'm going to make some progress, if I may, Presiding Officer, before thinking about another intervention. But the bottom line is we need people who can inspire and link to real life. And I'm going to talk about some women in relation to science and things. And I'm going to start with Mary Queen of Scots and one of my topics in which I'm particularly interested, which is cryptography. And Mary Queen of Scots used to use a method for corresponding with her lovers, which is actually, in structural terms, exactly the same method that is used by the public key cryptography on the internet and elsewhere that protects our highly sensitive data. She had a box with two locks. She had the key to one lock. Her lover had the key to the other lock. She would put her message in the box and lock her lock. The box would go to her lover, he would lock his lock. It would come back to her, she would unlock her lock. It would go back to him, he would unlock his lock. There was only one key, never left the respective people. Because compromising the key is the thing that makes it difficult. And that is the basis, hundreds of years later, of how we protect modern financial information. So Mary Queen of Scots, a historic hook, but a very important one that lives on in modern cryptology. We've had a few politicians who've been scientists. Indeed, Isaac Newton was an MP for a period of time. I have to say his contribution to Parliament was relatively modest. He only made a single contribution to Parliament when he asked if the window could be shut because there was a rather disturbing draft blowing along the back benches. But at least he was in Parliament and the opportunity was there. I want to speak about another woman, Ada Lovelace, who was Charles Babbage's programmer. Charles Babbage had a lot of public money to develop the difference engine and the analytical engine, which were mechanical computers, which it wasn't possible to engineer to the required standard. And Ada Lovelace developed the algorithms for these machines. Another woman who in the modern age was Rear Admiral Grace Hopper, who developed the language which is still used in commercial programming today, COBOL, retired three times, was brought back to the United States Navy because she turned out to be indispensable. After two retirements, she was brought back, died in harness as a researcher at the age of 86. So there's plenty of women around. We just have to get the message out. The relationship between scientists and public discourse is often a little uncomfortable one. We think of the first computer being the Mark I the computers in the United States. Actually, the first computer that was capable of being programmed was built by a post office engineer called Tommy Flowers, who was based at Dollis Hill Laboratory in London. And he developed that in 1944, 6 days before the D-Day landings. It was available, and it was an indispensable tool for that. He had to pay for it himself, and the state never fully compensated him for it. Good examples from good scientists as well. Richard Feynman was able to show why the Challenger space shuttle failed without speaking a single word. He took the rubber ring from the solid booster rockets on the Challenger that had been the point of failure, dipped it in liquid nitrogen live on TV during a congressional hearing, tapped the rubber ring on the desk, and it shattered. He didn't say a word, but he found the way of illustrating how science could affect real life. And I hope that we've lots of people who can do that. Let's think just briefly in my concluding remarks, Presiding Officer, a few people who are scientists. And actually, I have Ian Gray on the list, and I have Richard Simpson on the list, Sam Galbraith, and of course, Jack McConnell, I think, took forward tobacco legislation because he understood many of the scientific arguments. It's not always good news. Margaret Thatcher was the first and only Westminster Prime Minister who was a chemist, and one of the first things she did was to cut grants for chemistry research. Let me just close by quoting another woman, Dorothy L. Sayers, who put into the mouth of Peter Whimsey, the detective that she wrote, perhaps something very important about science. Peter Whimsey, she has saying, "The only ethical principle which has made science possible is that the truth should be told all the time. If we do not penalise false statements made in error, we open the way for false statements made by intention. And a false statement of fact made deliberately is the most serious crime a scientist can commit. Scientists are our guardians of truth and knowledge, and we should do everything we can to support them and encourage others, especially women, to follow in their illustrious footsteps." Presiding Officer.